In this video, we're going to learn about the solution process. So first, we'll talk about how fast something can dissolve in something else and what factors affect that. So the first thing is there's temperature. If you're trying to dissolve sugar in water, well, you know from coffee, perhaps, that sugar will dissolve much faster in hot coffee than in iced coffee. Typically, the rate of dissolution happens, it's much faster with increasing temperature. Also, the surface area of the solute is relevant. So for example, if I'm making coffee and I drop a sugar cube into it, it will dissolve much more slowly than if I drop in some granulated sugar. Granulated sugar, there's more contact, more points of contact with the water, with the coffee, and that allows for dissolution to happen faster. Thirdly, there's agitation. If I dump sugar into my coffee, it will not dissolve fast. But if I stir it, then that will greatly accelerate the process. Next, we're going to talk about solubility, which is defined as how much of a solute is capable of dissolving in a certain amount of a solvent at any given temperature. And this is based on an equilibrium process. So the equilibrium is reached when the rate of something dissolving is equal to the rate of it crystallizing from the solution back into the solid state. So you may actually have a real world understanding of this through if you're having iced coffee. Yes, it takes forever to dissolve all of your sugar in the iced coffee, but if you really pay attention, if you dump some sugar into your iced coffee, the first little bit of sugar dissolves quite quickly. It'll take you all day to dissolve all of it, but the rate of dissolution decreases as more and more sugar gets dissolved. Certainly the first little bit goes pretty quickly, and then it slows down, slows down, slows down, and those last few granules take forever. This is because initially you have the maximum amount of sugar there, so it'll dissolve faster, and as you have less and less sugar, there's less to dissolve, so it's going to go at a slower rate. Moreover, the sugar that has dissolved will crystallize out to an extent. Initially, that doesn't happen at all because there's no dissolved sugar at all. But as you build up more and more dissolved sugar, the rate of crystallization increases. And with equilibrium processes, eventually you reach some kind of equilibrium point where the rate of dissolution and the rate of recrystallization are equal. Now, whether this is an equilibrium that's reached after only a tiny amount of dissolution or after a lot, it depends on what you're trying to dissolve. Certain things dissolve very easily, other things don't. And I also want to point out that where this equilibrium point is does depend on temperature. So sugar is very, very much, its solubility is very much dependent on temperature. So at higher temperatures, you're going to have an equilibrium point reached at a much higher amount of solute dissolved. At lower temperature, it should be a much lesser amount of solute dissolved, again, for sugar. So let's talk about saturated, unsaturated, and supersaturated solutions. A saturated solution contains the absolute maximum amount of solute in a given amount of solvent. An unsaturated solution contains anything less than that. Any coffee that you're having will be an unsaturated solution of sugar in your coffee. A supersaturated solution contains more than the theoretical maximum amount of solute in the given amount of solvent, which probably is something that you're scratching your heads about. Like, how could you possibly reach this point if it's past the theoretical maximum? Well, let's take a look at the solubility of sugar in water. At 90 degrees Celsius, the solubility of sugar in water is about 420 grams about 420 grams of sucrose, which is sugar, per every 100 milliliters of water. So that is a very, very syrupy mixture. but if we go down in temperature to, say, you know, maybe 20 degrees, which is like room temperature, if we go down to about room temperature, we find that our maximum here is at 200-ish grams. So this is 200 grams of sugar per 100 mils of water. Sorry, 200 grams of sugar per 100 milliliters of water. So let's say that you made a saturated solution of sugar in water at 90 degrees Celsius. Say you took 100 mils of water and you dissolved 420 grams in it. Nothing more could possibly go in at 90 degrees Celsius. But let's say you cool it. Well, you cool it, it goes down to 80 to 70 to 60 degrees, and you still have 420 grams of sugar in that 100 mils of water. 50, 40, 30, 20. Okay, you hit 20 degrees, and now you're at more than double the theoretical maximum possible amount of sugar dissolved. If you keep cooling it, it might just start to crystallize out anyway, but it's possible that you'll reach this, you'll stay at this unstable state until it's disturbed. Now, disturbing it might be as simple as shaking it a little bit, poking it. If you put the tiniest little seed of something solid into the solution, that might be enough to cause crystallization to occur. And that's actually how reusable hand warmers work. More on that later. So the next principle to consider is that like dissolves like, which means that polar solutes are soluble in polar solvents. An example would be salt, which is about as polar as it gets, because it's an ionic compound with formal positive and formal negative charges. So salt is soluble in water, but on the other hand, CH4 is not insoluble. And the reason for this is that CH4 is a nonpolar substance. But a nonpolar solute is soluble in a nonpolar solvent. So for example, we could consider, our nonpolar solvent is going to be CCl4, which is, there are polar bonds in it, but it's symmetrical, so this is nonpolar. And so in CCl4, we can say that toluene, which is paint thinner, is soluble in it. We could say actually that plastics can dissolve, and they're nonpolar. Plastics are soluble in CCl4. So let's talk about why like dissolves like. Here's an example of the solvation of an ionic compound. So let's say that we've got this crystal structure of sodium chloride. Look at how angular it is. Everything is very neatly organized, and you've got a recurring pattern of positive sodium and negative chloride ions. Well, what happens is my lone pairs on my oxygen in water are partially negative. They're partially negative. And so they will engulf the sodium ions that are in the crystal. So these lone pairs are going to come over here and attract the sodium ion. And there will be another water molecule that does the same, and another, and they will just engulf this sodium ion such that the partially negative oxygens are surrounding the sodium ion. Similarly, the chloride ion will be surrounded by the hydrogens in water. And that's why we see the partially positive hydrogens in water attracted to the negative ions in of chloride. Again, this is all due to the polarity of water, which is partial positive with the hydrogens and partial negative with the oxygen. So let's talk next about enthalpy of solution, which is the energy associated with dissolving something. At its core, you can look at the process that we just did, that we just showed here. You can look at that as three things happening. Step one is the ions in the crystal all separate from each other. So we've got a whole bunch of ion-ion interactions. Those are strong forces of attraction. But let's say we've got them all in the right place, and then we separate them all from one another. If we do that, we've got to pull hard. We've got to invest energy to break them apart. And the energy is going to be actually the opposite of the lattice energy. So that is going to be an endothermic process. It's going to be a process where it requires heat to be absorbed. Again, you've got to pull these ions apart. So that's why when the solute becomes separate solute particles, this is going to be something that's endothermic, meaning it has a positive change in internal in enthalpy. Similarly, we also have to take some solvent molecules and separate them from each other to accommodate the solute particles. So we're going to be breaking some hydrogen bonds here. And anytime you're breaking bonds, anytime you're pulling apart attracted particles, it is an endothermic process. So similarly, this step, step one, is going to be with a positive delta H, a positive change in heat. So those are two processes that are generally unfavorable. It requires really pulling on them to make it happen. But there's a big payoff when we have these separated particles that come together and form interactions like, well, these, where the partial positives in water and the negative ions are attracted, and the partial negatives in water, and the positive ions are attracted. When you form those interactions, that is going to be with a release of heat. You take two magnets and you put them next to each other and you let go, they'll just stick together. There will be a release of energy as they come together. There's a release of potential energy as they come together. So that loss of energy, it may cancel out exactly these other two steps. It may not quite cancel them out. And you have an overall endothermic process where energy is absorbed. That happens when you use an instant cold pack and you break a barrier between water and a salt, and that salt starts to dissolve. And these three things happen, and overall, it's going to be endothermic. You have, you know, right here is our overall change in energy, not all the way down. But if you have a case where heat is released, as in the case of hand warmers, then the delta H is going to be bigger. Delta H3 is going to be bigger, meaning that the attractive forces between the solute and the solvent, that interaction is going to more than cancel out the energy required to pull apart the ions and the solvent molecules. So we won't do calculations with these, but it's good to understand this three-step process for enthalpy of solution. Really, formation of bonds is always going to release energy. Breaking bonds is always going to absorb energy. Couple other things. We can have liquids dissolving in liquids. Miscible liquids, when the liquids are miscible in one another, we're talking about they dissolve in one another. So we could have alcohol is very much miscible in water. And immiscible liquids, we could have, say, if we have water and oil, they will be immiscible in one another. It's just a term that we use. It basically means solubility or soluble. Whether we're talking about, say, liquids in liquids versus solids in liquids. Also, another thing is the solubility of gases in liquids. And the solubility of gases in liquids decreases with increasing temperature, which is different because with solids, typically speaking, Solids become more soluble with increasing temperature. Think sugar and water. But with gases, gas solubility decreases as temperature rises. And that's why, actually, if you pour yourself a glass of water, there is dissolved air in your glass of water. And as it heats up to room temperature, you'll start to see bubbles come out of that solution. Also, the solubility of gases is proportional to pressure. So the higher the pressure, the higher the solubility of gases. And Henry's law states just this. So if I have a certain amount of pressure, these gas particles will be somewhat soluble. But if I increase the pressure, if I force those gas particles into solution, we can see that more will be dissolved. And classic case is a can of soda. Can of soda is at very high pressure. And once you release the pressure, immediately the solubility of carbon dioxide in the water, in the soda, it decreases massively and you get bubbling out immediately. So that is that. We're going to do some practice problems with solubility in the next video. But for now, hope you've enjoyed this. Hope it's helpful. Let me know if you have any questions or comments in the comment section below. Thank you.